Okay, so good morning. This morning we're starting a new unit called Let's Talk About Stress. And I thought, seeing we're in church, we'd begin with confession. I won't be confessing, you will. It's good. Easier for me that way. Okay, so let's do a quick impromptu survey. So if in the past year, right, the last 12 months, if you've experienced almost no stress at all, would you just raise your hand? Okay, good. If you've taken a lot of drugs in the last year, would you? How about in the last year, if you've experienced a moderate amount of stress? Any of that? Okay. Fair bit. And who in the last year has experienced a lot of stress? A lot of stress. Okay, good. Me too. And interesting and unsurprising, actually. And I think that's why we should talk about it. Stress, let's just get out in the open. Stress is a normal part of life. And if you're expecting that you should be able to go through life and not experience stress, then you need to get real and grow up. Right? Stress is a normal part of life. But the irony of stress is that the thing you're stressed about probably won't kill you. But stressing about it probably will. That's the next 4 weeks in a nutshell. The thing you're stressed about probably won't kill you, but stressing about it probably will. Now, let me begin with a little bit of disclaimer in case there are any lawyers watching online. When I talk about stress, I am not talking as a doctor or as a counselor. I have expertise in neither of these areas. When I talk about stress, I'm talking about it, I'm afraid, as a student of ancient texts. And from that perspective, I can tell you that in the ancient world, scholars from all sorts of disciplines were fascinated by the science of happiness. Lots of brilliant minds spent their entire careers trying to figure out what it was that made human beings happy. And there was a general consensus that one of the requirements for happiness was a freedom from stress. They called this state of mind tranquillitas animi, tranquility of mind. And my hope for you, my prayer for you, is that over the next 4 weeks in church, you will experience, or at the very least be motivated to experience, a measure of this tranquility. And I have this hope for you because I think that life is just way too short for you to be stressed out about stuff that might not happen. Stressed out about stuff that doesn't really matter, and about stuff that you can't do anything about anyway. I should also say, by way of preamble, that when we talk about stress, we are only sort of, talking about the things that you're afraid of. We're all afraid of something, and it keeps us up at night quite often. I think that fairly early on in the evolutionary process, our species realized that life on Earth is highly uncertain. In fact, this realization predates our species. We know for a fact that the early clans of Neanderthal were very, very worried about stuff. They stressed out about whether or not they'd be able to catch an animal on tomorrow's hunt, or whether or not they'd have enough shelter for the winter. And we're 10,000 years after that and more, but we still have the same genes, we still have the same stuff, and we still have the same primal fears. We don't worry about whether or not we'll catch a mammoth tomorrow, but we do worry about whether or not we'll make a sale tomorrow, or whether or not we'll still have a job by 5 o'clock tomorrow night. It's the same stuff. And to a certain extent, that kind of fear is good. To a certain extent, that kind of fear is necessary because it motivates you to try harder and to keep going and to kill more mammoths. So a lot of the things that you fear in life are entirely appropriate and entirely within the bounds of probability. You might have a fear of not being able to meet an important deadline. You might have a fear of failing an important exam. You might have a fear of being laid off. You might have a fear of not being able to fund your own retirement, of not being able to pay your bills. And that fear of what might happen is somewhat motivational. It, as they say, gets you up in the morning. That primal fear that we've inherited from our ancestors is one of the things that drives us. It drives the global economy, actually. And in some cases, then, fear is good. Fear is a necessity. For example, if you're an engineer and you're designing a new plane that one day you expect me to fly on, I'd like you to be a little stressed. I'd like you to experience a sleepless night or two. I'd like you to feel that you need to get up at 2 o'clock in the morning and recheck your calculus. I'd like you to be worried. But stress, the kind that we're talking about in this unit, is only sort of like that. In the ancient world, students of this subject noticed that, people got stressed about all sorts of things without being able to specify exactly what it was they were stressed about. They weren't all that good at articulating which of their worries were legitimate and therefore useful, and which of them were illegitimate and inappropriate and therefore disabling. Indeed, they noticed that it is a characteristic of our species that we get stressed out without knowing exactly what it is we're getting stressed out about. They noticed that it's typical of humans to get stressed out about what we might call stupid stuff. Stuff that might not happen. Stuff that does not matter. And stuff that you simply can't do anything about. And that kind of stress is the worst kind of stress. The Danish philosopher Søren Kierkegaard said that no torturer has in mind such exquisite pain as that of stresses. Sometimes, in fact, the stress is so bad that you feel it physically without being able to put your finger on why you're feeling it. You get stressed without knowing why you're stressed. And that kind of stress about what might happen, stress about things that don't matter, stress about stuff you can't do anything about, that kind of stress is bad for you. One old Jewish text called the Wisdom of Sirach said that stress will bring about old age too soon. Some of you are in your 50s, you look like you're in your 50s, but you're actually only 25. I think we all know that's true. We all know that being stressed is hard work. We all know that being stressed is desperately exhausting. You don't need to be a student of ancient texts to know that being stressed is a brilliantly efficient way to rob yourself of happiness. And because stress is such an inevitable and often dangerous aspect of our humanity, we need to talk about it in church, and we need to figure out how we might be able to help ourselves. And I think one of the self-helps that we all need is learning how to figure out which of our stresses are worth it and which of them are not. And to that end, I want to talk to you about a few of the things that Jesus had to say about this subject. So this morning and next week, we're looking at the Gospel according to St. Matthew, chapter 6 and verse 25, where Jesus says, now you might want to get your notebooks out at this point, because this is brilliant. Like, drum roll, please. Here's what the greatest teacher in the world had to say. Do not worry about your life. Let's all go home. We're done. Do you know what I mean? The word worry that we use today comes from a very old German word, Bergen, that basically means to strangle. So if you lived in 16th century Europe and someone came up to you and put their hands roughly around your throat and started to squeeze on your windpipe, you would say of that experience that you were being stressed. This person was stressing you out. And I think then it's a brilliant word to describe that thing that happens to you when you get stressed. Because when you get stressed, it puts a squeeze on you. It chokes the ability for you to function in life and be happy. And because this stressful strangulation is so bad for you, this is why Jesus says, don't do it. Stop worrying. What Jesus is basically saying in this sentence is, hey, dude, seriously, just stop. You've been doing this too long. Just stop. It's not good for you. You're spoiling your own life, stressing out about things that probably won't happen, stressing out about things that really don't matter, stressing out about things that you can't do anything about anyway, and it's bad for your health, it's bad for your future, it makes you horrible to be around, your wife hates you because of it. Just stop. Just stop. Which I have to say, pardon me, Jesus, I have to say, this is a wee bit naive, don't you think? I mean, it's not as if you're going to be in one of those stressed out seasons of life and it's 2 a.m. in the morning and in hope you turn to the Bible by your bedside and you flick to this bit where Jesus says this sentence and you read it and you go, oh, okay, I feel better already. Jesus says, don't worry. Okay, I guess I won't worry. I guess my bills will pay themselves. It's okay. Thanks, Jesus. Life tends not to be that simple. And so Jesus goes on and makes it worse. And he makes it worse by getting specific. He says, don't worry about your life, and then he defines life. He says, don't worry about your life as in what you will eat. Don't worry about your life as in your body. Okay? Don't worry about your life as in what you will wear. So evidently, when Jesus uses the word life in this sentence, he uses it in a really, really basic, fundamental sense. He means life as in, okay, so there's nothing in the fridge, and you have to go shopping for groceries tomorrow. How are you going to pay for them? Life as in, it's cold outside, you may have noticed. And the kids need new boots for winter, and the kids need a winter jacket. And that stuff's not cheap, and money doesn't grow on trees, you may have noticed. How are you going to pay for it? Were Jesus speaking these words in our culture, he would no doubt talk about sending your children to university and how you're going to fund it, funding your retirement, getting established in your chosen career, avoiding the next round of layoffs, you know, all the things that you stress about, things that you would think would be well within the parameters of legitimate, valuable stress. Things that do matter, things that most certainly are important. And yet Jesus looks at all those things and says, don't worry about them. Don't worry about them. And when he says this, I don't think he's saying that the things that stress you out aren't important. On the contrary, they're very important. Buying your groceries, taking care of your children, funding your retirement, all that stuff is essential for life, and you need to take care of that stuff. But the rub is, and here's why you get stressed about it, the rub is that taking care of so much of life's essential stuff has to do with the future. And the future is, by definition, uncertain. And so what Jesus seems to be saying here is that there is a way to take care of an uncertain future without stressing about it excessively in the present. There is a way about staring into the cold, scary unpredictability of all your tomorrows without allowing all of that scariness and unpredictability to ruin your experience and enjoyment of life in the present. And that way, like so many other ways in life, involves getting your head on straight. He says, think about it, please. think about it carefully. Is life not more than food? Is the body not more than clothes? Now, Jesus said this to poor people in the first century. He said this to people for whom things like food and clothing were by no means guaranteed. And in this sentence, he tries to take the sting out of their stress. And you'll notice, I mean, let's get real about it, it's a stress about money. The thing, I could do another impromptu survey, I won't, but if I asked you to raise your hand if you ever get stressed about money, probably most of you would put your hand up. This is one of the things that our species, presently and historically, most often worries about. And it's no surprise, therefore, to learn that the Bible, like all other religious texts, talks about money quite often. In fact, it may surprise you to learn that the Bible talks about money more than it does about prayer and faith combined. Isn't that amazing? The Bible's got more to say about the penny in your pocket. I was British there for a second. And than it does about how much you pray and how much you believe. The Bible's very real about this. However, most of what the Bible says about money isn't all that good. And the reason the Bible takes quite a harsh view when it talks about money is because I think the Bible knows that people tend to equate money with life. People think that money equals life. And in this sentence, Jesus basically says that equation is a fallacy. Think about it. When you run out of money, do you run out of life? When the money ends, does the life end? When it's the 29th day of the month and there's nothing left in the bank, do you die? No. Indeed, is it possible, here's a question, is it possible for a person to be so poor that they don't have a pot to pee in and yet they are still full of happiness and joy and love and pleasure? Is that possible? Do you know such a person? So the question that Jesus asks here is, and it's a question that touches us all, is your life as a human being too closely equated with things like paying for your children's education? Is your life too closely tied up with funding your retirement, making a sale tomorrow? Or if I can phrase those questions in a slightly alternative way, if you spent less time being worried about the future, would your life be better or worse? If you just made a decision to stress out less, would you be better or would you be worse? And while you're thinking about that, let's go to the next sentence. Jesus says, look at the birds of the air. And I say no. Like, if I came to Jesus stressed, that would stress me out more. Can you imagine how that conversation would go? Jesus, I'm stressed, can you help me? Look at the birds of the air, my son. What? What am I, a bird watcher? Do you see an anorak on me? I'm stressed. I got stuff to do. I don't have time to look at the bird. I'm busy. The birds of the air. This is what I get. I always hated this kind of thing about Jesus. Look at the birds of the air. No. But because you're Jesus, I'll do it, okay? I'll play along, right. Look at the birds of the air. I'm looking, Jesus. What do you want me to see? Right. The birds, he says, do not sow or reap or store stuff in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? In the ancient world, teachers like Jesus were quite often interested in the natural world, and so they quite often said this kind of thing. And forgive me for saying this, I find this sort of saying in the Bible quite patronizing. The point of this saying is, and this will be news to no one, that birds do not engage in human activity. Thanks, Jesus. That is, the birds do not do any of the things that we feel we have to do and do have to do in order to provide for themselves. The birds, for example, do not feel the need to have a profile on LinkedIn. The birds, for example, do not feel a need to invest in a RRSP. The birds don't feel a need to network to further their chosen career. The birds don't feel a need to pressure their children to play rep hockey. In fact, when the birds' children are a certain age, they just throw them out of the nest and say good luck. Which might be the way to go, actually. Good luck, hope you make it. Let me know how it goes. And the thing is, for the birds, it all kind of works out in the end, right? They don't have much, they don't do much, they don't have much aspirations, but they're still birds, and it all kind of works out for them. Without too much effort is the point that Jesus makes, ostensibly. And of course, it's not really true. At a certain level, what Jesus is saying here isn't true. And even in the ancient world, even Jesus' original audience knew that what Jesus was saying here wasn't quite correct. The fact is, birds do work. The fact is, birds do understand that the world doesn't owe them a living. The fact is, even the dumbest bird in Bird Street understands that worms don't jump into the nest, right? They got to leave the nest and go get the worms, go digging, right? Otherwise, no worms. That's how it works when you're a bird, right? So when Jesus says what he says here, what he's not saying is that it would be the thing to do to sit in our basement all day and eat Cheetos and expect that other people are going to pay our bills in this world. That's not what Jesus is saying. Far from it. Indeed, the Bible is very explicit, I think, about the need for industry. The Bible says really hard stuff, actually. It says stuff like, if you don't work, you don't eat. The Bible says stuff like, I'm sorry, it's your job to look after yourself. It's your job to take care of your family and so on and so forth. And we all get that. So the point that Jesus is making here is not that the birds of the air don't work, but rather, listen carefully, as they work, they do so without any presumptions about the future. And because they have no presumptions about the future, they just don't worry. They take one day at a time. And that's the great thing about the days of our life, isn't it? However many they are, they come one at a time. And when you worry too much about the future, here's what you do. You try and disrespect the fact that life happens one day at a time. And what you do is you add up in your head the grand total of everything that might go wrong in your life. And in one torturous moment, you get an awful and an unlikely picture of the worst possible scenarios of life. And so in this torturous second, your children are estranged from you, you don't have a job, you don't have enough money to retire on, your wife has left you, you don't have a home, you're lying in the fetal position, sucking your thumb in some government facility, and you're going to end up living in a trailer. That's your future. And you see all that in that moment. And you know what? That actually might happen to you. All your worst fears about the future might come true. But they won't all come true today, will they? Unless you're really unlucky. All the bad stuff that's ever going to happen to you in life, and there will be bad stuff, right? Get real. There will be. But it won't all happen today. But if you add up in your mind everything that might go wrong, may go wrong, and you allow all of that as yet unhappened pain to weigh on your mind, the weight of that will crush you. You simply can't bear the weight of a lifetime's problems all at once. And that is why, and here's the point Jesus is making, the way to live is like the birds, without presumptions. Just one day at a time. Just one day at a time. Because no matter how bad things get, believe me, no matter how bad things get, how black your hole is, you can hack one day at a time. You've got strength for that. You're good enough for that. One day at a time. And that's what Jesus means when he talks about the birds. They don't let the future get them down, neither should you. And I think the theological point that Jesus makes in all this, of course, is one of comparison. He's asking his audience to believe the unbelievable, really. He's asking his audience to believe that God will take care of them. Those of you who have read a book or two, I suppose, will know that we are thrown up and out from the evolutionary process. But the audacity, the joy, the boldness of sentences like this in the Bible is to say that that is not all that is true. We are so much more than a collection of leptons and neutrons and atoms hurtling through the cold, uncaring expanse of space. We are people whom God knows and about whom God cares. And this is the point that Jesus makes. He cares for you. Now, it'll work out. It just will. Look at this sentence. This sentence was written by one of the guys who wrote the Bible, and he's writing to his friends, and he's talking to them about stress, and he says, guys, keep your lives free from the love of money. Our need for money and the uncertainty of the future, they're huge stress factors in our lives. This stuff keeps you up at night. And so this Bible writer says, just don't do it anymore. Stop. It's not good for you. Instead, be content with what you have. Okay? I suppose your life isn't perfect. I suppose everything hasn't worked out quite according to plan. I suppose things haven't gone quite as well as you one day hoped they would. But imperfections and disappointments aside, I bet they're not all that bad. I bet you can find something in your life today to be happy-ish about. I bet there's something that's quite good and something that you should be glad for and that should make you content. And would that state of mind not be far better than living in a past that should have been better and wishing your life away into a future that might never happen? Is not the best frame of mind to be, I'm going to enjoy today. The past is gone, can't do anything about it, I can't get it back, I can't relive it. The future's uncertain, might never have it, might never happen. Who knows? Today I've got today. And I'm going to look at today and find something to make me smile. Something to make me glad. And of course the point he makes is that you're able as a believer to have that frame of mind because God has said, look at how the sentence ends, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. Now of course this is a statement of faith. I can't prove to you that there is a God, and I certainly can't prove to you that God, if he exists, cares for you. And so when the Bible says things to you like, you know, you don't need to worry about it, you don't need to stress about it, because God's got your back. No matter how bad it gets, God will never leave you. You'll always find God there for you in your blackest moment. When the Bible says that, the Bible is asking you to take something on faith. It's asking you to trust an uncertain future to an unseen God. And on that basis, and on that basis alone, stop stressing out. And why not? Why is that so crazy? Why is that such a bad idea? As far as the future is concerned, well, of course you have to make plans. Of course you have to be smart. You have to do your best. But there does come a time when you need to jolly well just stop worrying about it. And is that such a stupid thing to say? If you spent less time being stressed, would your life be better or worse? Would you perform better or worse? This happened to me a bit this week. Do you ever get stressed about your job, say? About your performance and how you're doing it. And you get so stressed that it stops you doing it well. Like performance anxiety, essentially. Okay. Let's all go over here. Right, that's a thing. Performance anxiety is one of the recognized anxieties in DSM-5. It's a thing we have. I'm not talking about naughty stuff. I'm talking about like a sportsman. When a sportsman gets overly stressed about his abilities, it stops him playing well.
Yes.
Right?
Maple Leafs.
Right? Yeah? Right, Maple Leafs, yeah. Maybe they should be a little more stressed. Right? If you stress out about making a sale tomorrow, and I'm not going to make a sale. I didn't make a sale last week, so I'm not going to make a sale this week. I can't do this. That's not going to help you make a sale. I think the better thing to do is just chill out in the morning and say, I've got this. I can do this. I've got it. It's going to be okay. I've got it. Happy to help. Anyway, next sentence. Jesus wraps it up and he says, can any of you by worrying add a single hour to your life? So what we're talking about here is life expectancy, and this is something that we're all interested in, I think. And if you go to the gym and you read one of those magazines, you will read stuff like if you get the requisite amount of exercise and if you take the right diet and if you eat the right amount of goji berries or whatever, all that stuff is good for you. But never, ever, ever anywhere will you read that the wrong kind of stress is good for you. Stress of the wrong sort improves neither the quantity nor the quality of life. But on the other side of the coin, you can definitely stress yourself into hospital. You can stress yourself into illness. You can stress yourself into an early grave. Dr. Charles Mayo, founder of the Mayo Clinic, said that stress affects the circulation, the heart, the glands, and the whole nervous system. He says, I've never met or known a man to die of overwork. I don't know about that. But I have known a lot of men who've died from stress. You know, we all live in the present. That's how our life works. And yet we too easily, as human beings, get stuck in either the past or the future. That's where we go wrong. Our mind gets stuck in a past that we can't change, or in a future that is by definition unpredictable and uncertain. And what's the point? All stress does is rob you of today. Stressing about stuff that doesn't matter, about stuff that might not happen, and about stuff that isn't really important, is a problem. Because stress robs you of time, and time, unlike money, does equal life. When you run out of time, you run out of life. When the time stops, so does the living. So why waste time stressing out about a past you can't change? Why waste time stressing out about a future that is entirely uncertain? Why stress about things that don't really matter, that you can't do anything about? Even if you are worrying about stuff that definitely will happen, and some of the bad things you're worrying about, they definitely are going to happen. Why spoil today worrying about them? Next week we're going to talk about how we can use our faith to reduce our stress, and you won't want to miss that. It's going to be awesome, I hope. And time for one question or two. Money's a difficult one. Well, it's only difficult because of what the Bible says, right? So the Bible's got a ton of stuff to say about money, and a lot of what it has to say isn't good. We know, in fact, that money is neutral. Money doesn't have a morality. Money is capable of neither good deeds nor bad deeds. It's just money. And so it's certainly possible for a person to have a wrong attitude about money and be very, very poor. And it's person to, just as it's possible for a person to have a wrong attitude about money who's very, very rich. I think everything is about the attitude. It's all about the attitude. So I think if we, what would be wrong about money? Greed would be wrong. Putting money before family, before generosity would be wrong. And in the context of this morning's stuff, stressing out about money is probably a bad idea. It probably just is, eh? Like, it's good to allow our stress about money to cause us to work and be imaginative and do whatever we can to make the best life that we can for ourselves and our families. Those are Christian principles. But we probably stress out about it too much and waste. Here's a classic example. We waste. How many people do you know who forgo so much of life today and forgo so many pleasures today and experiences today for a future that they may never have? How wise is it to say, travel today, enjoy good wine today, go on nice dates today, get pleasures today, because tomorrow you might not. You know, have them. You might have the money, but not the health. You might have the money, but not the time. Live today. You might be. Yeah. One more quick question. Yes. The Bible is a book of faith. Right. It's not a book of science. It's not a book of history. It's a book of faith. That isn't to say there isn't scientific and historical truth in it, but it is to say it's not that kind of book, it is a book of faith. And so what I mean by that is the large important propositions in the Bible, such as there is a God and he's got your back, right? That's a big biblical proposition. Or there is an evil in the world and that evil is tangible and real and out to spoil your life. Those are propositions. They can't particularly be proven or disproven. That's why people argue about them. I think the Christian thing is to take some of those propositions on faith. That is, I read what I see in the Bible and I kind of go with it. So a lot of the stuff that we spoke about this morning, for example, there's that sentence in the book of Hebrews, God has said, I will never leave you. And I'll never forsake you. I just have to believe that. And believing it is not innate for for me. It's a choice. And so when life is hard, when life is black, I have a choice. I can succumb to the hardness or the blackness, or I can dig deep and I can say, well, I'm choosing to believe right now. I'm choosing to have faith. Now, whether my belief is silly or not is a different conversation. Whether I believe that there is an actual devil or not is a different conversation. The conversation that we're talking about this morning is that belief bad for you? Is it such a silly thing to say, I'm choosing to believe that there is a God who cares about me? I'm choosing to believe that there's so much more to humanity than leptons and neutrons and atoms hurtling through space. I'm choosing to believe there is something else. Something that has something to do with me and that is personal. And it knows me and it loves me and it cares about me. That's where science and faith both kind of try and say the same, search for similar answers. And that's why it's possible for me to believe both those things. Yes, I believe in leptons and neutrons and atoms and so on. But I believe there is more. There is faith that I have. And I don't think it's such a silly thing to choose to believe. I don't think it's bad for you. I don't think it does you any harm. On the contrary, I think it does you a lot of good. But I can't prove that because it's faith. Is that fair enough? I think that's a great answer to your question. Like, that's it. We got to go. I don't even have time to even say even. I got to go. It's 22. See you next Sunday. It's going to be great next Sunday. Bring your stressed out friends. Thank you.
I'll tell you what it means.